I love Candyland. Anybody in here like Candyland? If you like Candyland, the game, it's a brilliant game. And the reason I love Candyland so much is it's very simple. Basically, you just take cards and you turn the cards over, and whatever color is on the card, you move to that particular space. And the whole thrust of the game is you go from the start all the way to Candyland. Candyland, though, is a very emotional game. We've played it for a long, long time with our kids and all sorts of emotions, you know, like they would pick a card they wouldn't like and they would throw the figures around the playroom, take the cards and scatter them. And because of that, many would get disqualified from the game. Candyland teaches obedience, following directions. It teaches colors. It teaches how to respond to the good times and the bad times. Yes, it's a children's game, but it reminds me of some other children we're going to talk about, the children of Israel, because they pretty much had the same response and reaction as my kids have had over the years when we used to play Candyland. Think about God's people. I'm talking about the Israelites. Think about this nation. Back in the book of Genesis, and it's interesting to put this together, we're going to talk about some general concepts today from the Bible. And so often when it comes to Scripture, we get so specific, many times we miss the general flow. So if you think in the book of Genesis, the first book in the Bible, God established a covenant with Abraham. Basically, you have the beginning of the Jewish nation. And Abraham's descendants moved to a land called Goshen. You remember Joe, don't you? I'm talking about Joseph. Joseph and his clan cruised down there. It was a great place. Generations melt off the clock. 450 years. So Israel goes from Joe to Mo. And then the Bible says there arose a guy, a leader, a president, a Pharaoh, who didn't know what Joe had done for Egypt. So he was absolutely clueless, and he saw all of these Jews. The Jews were enslaved, and it was a difficult, difficult situation. So that brings us to Candyland, because we're going to find out how Moses, this guy, here's Moses, we're going to find out how this guy led God's people all the way through this track, hopefully to a place called Canaan, the land flowing with milk and honey, or you could call it Canaandyland. Why are we studying this? Why the board game? I mean, why? Well, this is the way we learn. And also, too, as you peruse the New Testament, for example, think about the Apostle Paul. You know, St. Paul, this is the New Testament. Here's what he said referring to this story and the blessings that will accrue in your life and mine when we study this and know this stuff. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 6 and following. Here's what the Apostle Paul said in the New Testament. Now, these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Do not be idolaters, as some of them were, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. We should not commit sexual immorality. On this track, that happened. As some of them did, and in one day, 23,000 of them died. We should not test Christ, as some of them did, and were killed by snakes. Don't grumble, as some of them did, and were killed by the destroying angel. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So if you think you're standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. Candyland, this game, is analogous to the game of life. We read and we look at the children of Israel. The Apostle Paul says we learn from their example about what to do and what not to do, and it pretty much is an example of your walk and my walk in the Christian life, because the Bible says it's a winning walk. It's a trek. It's a journey. And basically, like this game, Candyland, we don't know what's in the cards. And sometimes we think, man, the deck is stacked against us. We turn the card over, and it's a color. And God simply says, trust and obey. So that's the way it is in your life and mine. God has a great purpose, a great plan for your life. Well, here's Moses, and he looks happy, doesn't he? Let's give him a high five, right? He chooses the first card I've already shown you. Oh, wow, it's red. Well, I wouldn't get that excited, Moses. It's just one step. But Moses had a miraculous and magical childhood. Here's Moses, and you probably know a little bit about him. If you don't, listen up. Moses was born when all of the babies were being killed. So here he is, born in captivity, yet through a strange set of circumstances we'll talk about next time, he was adopted into Pharaoh's family. He had the best education, the best wardrobe, the best technology, the best of everything in this family. And what's so striking about it is God's enemies were rearing him to become the next Pharaoh of Egypt. This is Moses, a Jew. God is so amazing. He's so intentional that many times he can cause your enemies and mine to bless us. Did you hear what I just said? The enemies of God ended up blessing Moses. They gave him this amazing education. You know he relied on that as he led these 2 million people through all of these different colors and this track to Candyland. Amazing. So you think, wow, I got a bunch of haters. Wow, these people don't like me. Wow, this family situation. God can use your enemies to tip you off to what's around the corner. Maybe the reason you're feeling persecuted right now at your school or maybe at the office is because God wants to show you through them what he has for you, what he has in store for you. And that's the situation with Moses. So Moses is happy. I mean, he's living the life, right? Yeah. Well, he draws another card. He's on a roll now. Double green. Double green. We used to like those doubles when we would play the Young Supersonic Candyland Championship. One green, and then we go all the way to another green. Here is when Moses makes a mistake. We all make mistakes, and here's what I love about the Bible. The Bible not only shows the strengths of characters, but also the weaknesses. Moses was a man of passion. He was a man who was aggressive. He saw his fellow Jews being taken advantage of, and the Bible says he looked one way, he looked the other way, and he killed an Egyptian who was abusing one of his countrymen. Took him out. He looked one way. He looked the other. He, though, forgot to look up. God sees everything. It's the omnipresence. It's the omniscience of God. God knows it all. There's no such thing as a secret text. There's no such thing as a closed office door or bedroom door. God sees it all. It's great to have passion. I want to go, hey, Moses, man, another high five. Boom, great job with your passion. Misplaced passion, though, can cause chaos. Isn't that true? Oh, I'm passionate about life. Well, that's awesome. God's given you that passion to be passionate about him and the life he has. Yet what can happen is, we can become passionate about the wrong things. How many people do we know? Oh, I'm passionate. And they look at what God has told them to do sexually, but they say, I'm just a passionate man, a passionate lady, and they go off the grid, off the board. It leads to chaos. Think about this Harvey Weinstein disaster. The guy has passion, misplaced passion. And there comes a point in someone's life where God will turn us over to our own lusts, and the result is chaos. So I've got to ask you, what about your passion? Well, I'm passionate for my family. Man, I'm passionate for my kids. Awesome. You got to be passionate for God, passionate for your family, and passionate for His church. Yeah, we can allow that passion, parents, to totally take us to the wrong place. All of a sudden, we don't go to church anymore. All of a sudden, we're not involved in church anymore. All of a sudden, we don't have our kids up here for age-appropriate teaching anymore because you're chasing the college scholarship. And what's so paradoxical is the money that you're paying for all of the AAU and the coaching and this and that would more than pay for a Yale education. Misplaced passion. And I'm not saying athletics are wrong or extracurricular activities are wrong, but it's so easy to do that. And that's what Moses did. So because of that, he was a fugitive. They wanted to take him out. So he draws another card. Again, this game, Candyland, you draw the cards and just follow the colors. What is it, Moses? Are you happy? Oh, he's smiling. He's like, get me out of here. It's double purple. Double purple. Man, I've never had this many doubles in my life, but it's happening. I don't know why. Here, but Moses, you got one more purple. He goes to a place called Midian. Where is Midian? Midian, the Bible calls it, is on the backside of the desert. He meets a beautiful woman there who becomes his wife. Moses is thinking, I totally messed up. I fumbled the ball. I mean, I was right there, and I missed this opportunity because of a misplaced passion in my life. Well, remember, God has a purpose and a plan for every single person here, an amazing agenda. We make mistakes. Moses' mistake led him out to the wilderness. And maybe right now you're going, wow, Ed, I mean, I feel like I'm in the wilderness because of what I've done. I've gone through a marriage or two. I'm trying to recover from this substance issue. I feel like I'm in the wilderness because I'm disenfranchised. I'm separate from my daughter or my son. Financially, I feel like I'm in the wilderness. Man, woman, the wilderness is real, is it not? Yet in the wilderness, what happened? God showed up in a massive way. And we're going to talk about this next time. Next time, I'm just going to tell you, this place will be packed. It's a kid-friendly experience. We've had some writers to write this whole sequence that I'm going to be a part of and others. I've never seen anything like it. That's all I'm going to say. It's going to be so informative, creative, and fun for the whole family. I won't even say it now. I'm so excited. I wanted to even get into it now, but I can't. But this is what I'm going to tell you. But we're turning all of our campuses into Candyland, not just worship centers, parking lot, everything. That's what I'll say. Hashtag can't wait for Candyland part two. Okay. So he's in the wilderness. And he has this burning bush experience. God shows up, and you've got this call on his life. So you might think, oh man, I've made so many mistakes. God can't use me anymore. I've screwed up so many times. God can't use me anymore. And the enemy himself is whispering in your ear, do you realize what you did? Do you think God can use you at Fellowship Church? Do you think you can really serve? Those are lies. Lies. Moses had this encounter with God. And this encounter, this calling was so amazing, even though he felt inadequate. Do you ever feel inadequate? I do. all the time. I drive up to this campus or our other campuses, I'm thinking, I can't believe I got to do this. I mean, God, what do I have to say? I have zero to say. I feel that. I feel inadequate every time I walk up on stage or do something. And I guess that's a good thing, because God is not concerned about our ability. He's concerned about our availability. And Moses was available. God calls him and God says, Moses, you are going to be the man to lead. He's like, what? To lead. I stutter. To lead, I feel insecure. To lead, I have nothing to say. To lead my people out of Egyptian slavery. I mean, we're talking about Egyptian slavery. Now, do you think Pharaoh is going to go, wow, that sounds great. We need to downsize. We need to lose 2 million people from our labor force. You think he's going to have that kind of reaction? What are you smoking? Well, check it out. The Rainbow Trail. You like that? The Rainbow Trail. There it is. Yeah, Rainbow Trail. So God called him, and he goes, takes this shortcut, the Rainbow Trail, and now, wow, he finds himself in Pharaoh's office. Wow. Pharaoh? Egypt? I mean, they taught me how to walk like an Egyptian and talk like an Egyptian, Moses is going to think to himself. But he's like, I'm asking Pharaoh, God says, let my people go. Pharaoh was like, yo. Moses was like, hey, Pharaoh, let my people go. Pharaoh refused. Refused. Here's what I've learned. It's best to obey God the first time. Because when you obey him the first time, that's when everything kind of hits on all cylinders. When we don't, we end up having some serious problems. And here's what happened. God sent plagues to pound the Egyptians, to pound Pharaoh. Maybe right now you're like, Ed, okay, you know what? I'm experiencing a plague. It's better the first time when someone challenges you, the first time to become a Christian, make that decision. The first time to begin devotions, make that decision. The first time to tithe, make that decision. The first time to live a pure life, I'm gonna do it. The first time is the best time to serve God. Yet Pharaoh totally blew it. So now you got, let me see if I can do this, 10 plagues. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Because the card that Mo drew, my favorite. If you're a Candyland veteran, when you draw Queen Frostine, I mean, this girl is amazing, because you pretty much won the game if you choose Queen Frostine early as the game is developing. You know, in the Cowboys or the Dolphins, if they can get Queen Frostine early, they'll win the game. So, check him out. He goes to Queen Frostine. And again, I think about the emotion of our kids in these games. It was absolutely hilarious to watch. But again, because of their reactions, they would become disqualified and they would have to sit out and watch their other sisters and brother many times play the game. But Queen Frostine was a very, very coveted card. So Moses now is doing the stuff. He is going to lead God's people through Gumdrop Pass on his way to Canaanite land, God's chosen tract of land that he mentioned again earlier in the book of Genesis to Abraham. That's the covenant. God is a covenant God. He makes a covenant. And of course, the ultimate covenant being Jesus dying on the cross for our sins and rising again. So Moses is like, wow, okay, we're gone. We're out of here. See you later. So he takes 2 million people across Gumdrop Pass, and he's following, the Bible says, the cloud. And the cloud went right ahead of them. It's like this GPS thing that we use with all of our, you know, technology. And this cloud just moved in front of them, and they followed the cloud. At night, it was a fire in the sky, yet the cloud took them to the Red Sea. The Red Sea was miraculously parted. The Egyptians followed Moses and the children of Israel when they walked through the ocean floor and on the dry land. The waters engulfed them. They were taken out, miracle after miracle. They had this worship concert, God's people did, after they made it through the Red Sea. Yet these people still grumbled. They still murmured. They still went negative. Even though God did these great things, all they have to do was look back. 14 times, for example, in the book of Numbers, they just whined. They just grumbled. Let's all grumble together right now. Here's how we do it. On the count of three, just kind of do like this. Just say grumble, 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 grumble. I want us to do it here and at all of our campuses. You ready? 1, 2, 3. Grumble, 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 grumble. I can't believe this. This is awful. Oh, come on, come on. Grumble, 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 grumble. Yeah. That's what poor Moses had to deal with. Millions of grumblers. You're like, man, that sounds like my family. Well, sometimes people do grumble. And God understands our emotions, but man, we can grumble way, way, way too much. They followed, though, the cloud. Read here, the cloud is a picture, an example of the Holy Spirit of God. As we live life, we have a choice. We either yield ourselves and walk in the Spirit down this amazing track that God has for us, or we live the self-yielded life. It's either the Spirit-yielded life or the self-yielded life. And how many people do we know? And how many times in our own lives do we just go by what makes me look good, what makes me feel good, what brings passion to me? We forget the Spirit-led life. And the Spirit-led life is the life of success. It's not always easy, but it's the life of the ultimate. So, man, good things were happening. Let's see what else is in the cards. I mean, who knows what's going to be here? I mean, we're playing Candyland, right? You have no idea. You have no idea what's going to happen to you tomorrow. You have no idea what's in the cards for you next week, next month, next year. You don't know. I don't know. That's the adventure of following the Lord. God, I want to stay on your path no matter what. And even though these cards that I turn over can be really unique, I'm just going to trust you, God. I'm going to obey you. But see, we have a choice in the matter. Oh, look, another double. It's ridiculous. How does this happen? I don't know. It was double green, right? Okay, good. One. See, this is why Candyland is on my level. Two. Double green. What happened at double green? The children of Israel, let's go back. Followed the cloud, Red Sea parted, they had this worship concert, people still started grumbling. We're thirsty, mommy and daddy. We want food. And God rained down, and we'll talk about this next time, manna, candy bars, because manna tasted like honey from heaven. Some were paleo. Here's some quail. He gave them quail. So they go all the way to Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai. And it's interesting to study. I don't have time to follow this. It's interesting to study how many times mountains are mentioned in the Bible. Very interesting. Well, Moses scales Mount Sinai and receives the Ten Commandments. So they're doing the KOA thing. 2 million Jews, they're camping at the base of Mount Sinai. Mo goes up, gets the Ten Commandments, comes down, and goes back up. He gets other laws and other ways to live. The tabernacle system is set up. The worship is set up. Moses is setting up their offensive strategy to go through the rest of the trek into the promised land. This trek was supposed to take 40 days. Say 40 days with me. 40 days. It was supposed to be a short little jaunt, but it turned into a 40-year road trip from hell. How can you take a little 40-day trip and turn it into a 40-year road trip from hell? We're going to find out. So they're at the mountain. And even when Moses would go up for a while and come back down, all this drama and trauma, sexual immorality, idolatry, and this whole, really, if you had to put this whole thing in a phrase when it comes to God's people, rinse and repeat. Rinse and repeat. God, we love you. They would turn their backs on him, disobey him. God would discipline them. Then reconciliation has happened time and time and time and time and time and time again. And finally, the patience of God just is, you know, it just wears out. So anyway, Mo is here, and finally he gets everybody together. Let's go and take out who we have to take out. Let's go and claim the promised land. So now, this is a brilliant offensive strategy that he has. He's dialing up some serious offensive plays and stuff. So they move out. Oh yeah, they move out to the next card. Well, what is the next card? I forgot to draw it. I can't move because I'm not drawing the card. See? So what was I thinking there? I was about to break the rules of Candyland, disqualify myself from this incredible game. You won't believe this. You will not. I'm so lucky today. Try a double purple on, okay? Yes. Double purple. Whoa. Now we're going into the promised land. Hallelujah. They're right here on the edge, in the ledge of the promised land. All of God's people are on the edge of the promised land. They can't wait. They're like freaking out. And God goes, time out, time out. Send some spies out to check out Canaandyland. Here's what's so interesting about God. He doesn't just drop things on us like, something like this, we're gonna have to have aggressive, offensive faith. God says, the land is yours, take the land. So here's the strategy. He dials up a cool offensive strategy. Send some spies out. James Bond. Okay. They come back. This represents 12 spies. And they're like, Moses, man, the land is awesome, but there's giants in the land. These people are big. I mean, yeah, the land is cool, but these people are big and bad and amazing. And this negativity, this grumbling begins to become an infectious disease. And he tells this person, and then you have grumbling. And then here's what they do. They want to kill Moses. Then they say, man, I wish I was back in Egyptian slavery. This stuff is new. It's different. We're stepping out on faith, the unknown. I wish I was back in Egypt. What do you think, Bill? What do you think, Rhonda?
I agree.
Yeah, I agree. You know, where there's smoke, there's fire. I agree. This is crazy. Moses, I don't know. And let's vote on it. And I think we ought to kill Moses and Aaron, too. What do you think? Grumble. Have you ever noticed that whenever a bunch of human beings get together without leadership, we'll begin to grumble? Doesn't matter if it's at the garden club or the country club. Doesn't matter where it is. It could be at a CrossFit box. You get people together. Without leadership, grumble, negative. If you don't believe me, look at social media. It's the quickest race to the bottom, social media. Well, this was social media before social media. We got a problem. Now, there's a couple of guys, we'll talk about them next week. One I'll call Junior Mint, that's next week. I'll just give you a hint. They were like, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? They tell these negative people. Are you kidding me? We can take it. God's given it to us. Let's go. We got the mo. Let's go. No. Here's a biblical principle that we need to understand. God always gives us a greater measure of what we desire. So, when we die, God does not slam dunk anyone to hell. He simply gives us a greater measure of what we desired. If we kept God and his church and his people at an arm's length distance, he will say, you know what? That was your desire on earth. Here's your desire. I'll give you a greater measure of that. For eternity. The same is true. People go, you know what? I want to do what I want to do. I'm just going to be passionate about what I'm going to be passionate about. Again, go back to Harvey Weinstein. God just turns people over to their own lusts. I don't know when he pulls the trigger. I don't know when the defining moment is in a person's life, but I've seen it time and time and time and time again. And through Israel's grumblings, their negativity, their idolatry, their sexual immorality, because of this, I want to go back to Egypt. God gave them a greater measure of what they desired, because this is just unbelievable. They chose this card. They were like, where's Mr. Mint? I want to go back to Mr. Mint. I remember one time we were playing Candyland, and EJ was on the purple, ready to win the Young Supersonic Candyland Championship, and he drew Mr. Mint, had to go all the way back, and he started crying and throwing all those pieces and scattered the deck of cards, and that was just last week. So... all these people. I mean, how do you turn a 40-day vacation into the road trip from hell? Here's what it is. All these people went all the way back to Mr. Mint. They got a greater measure, right, of what they desire. You want Egypt? You got Egypt. You want Mr. Mint? You got Mr. Mint. They wondered in the desert for 40 years, God wiped them out. Wow, that's serious. That's sobering. What happened to Moses? What happened to Junior Mint, Joshua? What happened? I mean, what happened to Canaanland? I thought God keeps his promises. I mean, he does. And we'll talk about that next time. Okay? But here's the deal. Are you on this track? Are you on this journey of faith? Because if you are, the moment you start this relationship with God, you're promised Canaanland, heaven. So are you on this track? Have you been delivered from bondage, from slavery, like God's people were? It's not Moses who does the delivering. It's Jesus. Have you made that decision? Because if you have, that's the best thing that'll ever happen to you. If you have, this is a journey. This is the walk that will be challenging and uplifting and exciting for every person here. So do it God's way, and it'll take you to places you never dreamed possible. Okay? Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this church. I thank you for this opportunity we have to look back at 1 Corinthians and look back at the Apostle Paul and see how we can learn from these situations. I pray that we learn, and not just learn information, but also life application that leads to transformation. Maybe you're here and you're like, man, I can connect, Ed, with what you're saying. I've been seeing my enemies as opposed to people that God is maybe using in my life to bless me. Ed, I feel like I've made a mistake, and God can't forgive me for that one. Yes, he can. And he will if you repent. Maybe today is your moment of calling, your moment where you turn to God, your desert moment like Moses had. Maybe God is telling you and speaking to you and guiding you to do something that you've never thought possible, that you're ill-qualified to do, but God's saying right now, I don't want excuses. I just want your availability. Maybe it's time that we yield to the Spirit, not ourselves anymore, but by grace. And it's time for us to take the promised land with offensive faith. Not defensive faith, for the glory of God. We ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen.